Tonight, the Ministry of Education appeals for patience as students of the Chazelle Secondary School threaten protest action over conditions at the learning institution. Representatives from the CDB and the Eastern Caribbean Central Bank to help the government come up with a new VAT rate. The Ministry of Health not ruling out the possibility of a new mosquito-borne virus finding its way here. And multiple agencies come together to undertake a vector control project in Babineau. Very good evening to you. Welcome to the Thursday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polio. Our top story. The Ministry of Education has reacted with surprise to news of a planned protest by students of the Chazelle Secondary School. Parents and students have been complaining about the deplorable conditions at the school for years. In 2013, the then opposition United Workers Party applied pressure on the Senusia Labour Party government to address concerns about the structural integrity of the school as well as other issues affecting students. Today, the shoe is on the other foot, with pressure being brought to bear on the UWP government to address these same issues.
According to Chief Education Officer Marcus Edward, the ministry is disturbed by news of the planned protest, especially since the ministry in a statement earlier this month did indicate that the school was to receive immediate action and attention under a special government project called the Disaster Vulnerability Reduction Project.
In fact, the plan is to construct a new building to replace two of the existing blocks of the school. The two blocks which form the original school will be replaced by a brand new structure. And of course, all the other attendant issues will be dealt with.
The ministry is also concerned that the Students' Council has embarked on its current course of action without exhausting all of the avenues or options available to it for dispute resolution. As far as the CEO says he knows, the principal was not aware of the specific issues or grievances that led to the students' decision. The district education officer has also denied knowledge of the students' grievances. The CEO, meanwhile, says the ball has already started rolling on having the issues at the school addressed.
The bidding process is complete. The evaluation report from the evaluation team has been prepared, and the unit responsible for coordinating the project activity is on the verge of submitting the report to the World Bank for its no objection. Thereafter, an award of a contract will be made.
The ministry hopes this will happen in October and that construction will begin within weeks of the award of the contract. Contingency plans have also reportedly been put in place for once construction begins.
We anticipate that this would cause some inconvenience to the school, and that is why we have made arrangements for some classes of the Social Secondary School to be relocated to the facilities of the National Skills Development Center, which is in close proximity to the school, whilst the construction is taking place.
The expectation is that construction will be completed in time for the first term of the 2017 school year. In the interim, the CEO says the education officer has been instructed to visit the school and to meet with the students. He says steps are being taken to verify some of the students' complaints about an inadequate water supply and to address other complaints such as those about non-functioning AC units. The ministry has appealed for patience from the students while it attempts to address their grievances. For the DBS News World, Kendall Burton reporting.
In other news, representatives from the Caribbean Development Bank and the Eastern Caribbean Central Bank are working with the Ministry of Finance to get a snapshot of the St. Lucia economy. The results will hopefully provide the government with complete information to support long-term fiscal analysis and decision-making, including decisions about the way forward with the value-added tax. Don Nicholas has more.
Minister in the Ministry of Finance, Dr. Ubaldus Raymond, says his government has enlisted the help of the Caribbean Development Bank in doing an assessment on the status of St. Lucia's economy. He says the analysis is part of efforts to restructure the tax system. The government had promised to reduce the value-added tax, commonly referred to as VAT, in October.
We believe that it is important for any government, new government, to understand where it's starting and the strength or the weakness upon which it has to build its new policies. So this is exactly what the report is about. It gives us a broad overview of where we are as a country, where the fiscal position of the country is, and what needs to be done in order for us to rectify the problems that we are currently under.
Caribbean Development Bank officials are already in St. Lucia to assist with the project. They say the project hopes to make the high unemployment rate, especially among young people, a thing of the past.
And we've also looked at a scenario about what the government needs to do to set the fiscal accounts on a sustainable path, certainly by 2030. But in addition to that, we have provided the government with a comprehensive report that looks at a number of policy measures that can set St. Lucia on a very firm growth path that will ensure that the private sector becomes the engine of growth.
Officials gathered at the Office of the Government Information Service to discuss the way forward. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Just when medical officials thought they were finally getting a grip on the Zika virus, news from the U.S. is that researchers at the University of Florida have identified the Mayoro virus in an 8-year-old from Haiti, where there have been no known cases of the virus until now. The ministry is cautioning against panic, but is realistically not ruling out the possibility of the virus finding its way here.
The Mayoro virus was discovered in Trinidad in 1954. Since then, cases have been seen in Brazil, the Amazon, and some parts of South America. In 1999, there were two cases in the U.S. believed to have been picked up during a visit to Peru. Again in 2011, a Swiss tourist is believed to have picked up the virus again on a trip to Peru. And that is why the Ministry of Health here in St. Lucia is not ruling out the possibility of the virus finding its way here.
With global travel and trade, it has become more likely that we may get, because persons travel to certain areas where these diseases are present, it is quite likely that we may get, especially in the initial stages, isolated cases of those viruses.
The virus bears marked similarities to other vector-borne diseases, such as fever, headache, myalgia, rash, and pain in the large joints.
The symptoms are quite similar to the dengue fever in terms of the fever, the rash. It's also characteristic to have abdominal pain and joint pain, similar to the chikungunya virus. To date, we have never had any cases within St. Lucia or the rest of the region.
With news of the discovery of new or rare serotypes of dengue fever making the news in India, Singapore, and the U.S., the Ministry of Health here has also been attempting to put local anxieties to rest. According to Dr. Belmar George, while there are four strains, only two strains or types 1 and 2 have been seen locally.
It is also quite possible that serotypes 3 and 4, we can also see cases here as well. However, in past years, we've not had those cases as much as we've had serotype 1 and 2. And Dr. James Hospedalis was just indicating that it is a possibility that in 2017 or 2018, that we may see cases of serotypes 3 within the region.
This week, media reports had Dr. Glenn Morris, director of the University of Florida's Emerging Pathogens Institute, expressing the hope that, quote, hopefully we will not see the same massive epidemics that we saw with chikungunya, dengue, and now Zika. He went on to say, however, that these latest findings underscore the fact that there are additional viruses waiting on the wings that may pose threats in the future and for which we need to be watching out. For the DBS News World, Kendall Burton reporting.
Still in the first segment of the DBS News World, former Chief Air Services negotiator Ambassador Earl Huntley has reacted to Prime Minister Alan Shasta's intention to have Trinidad-owned Caribbean Airlines become St. Lucia's national air carrier. He made a comment last evening during an appearance on the DBS special News Make Alive in light of growing frustration with regional airline LIAT. Here is Don Nicholas with more.
Former Chief Air Services negotiator Earl Huntley recalls that in 1984, he signed an agreement which allowed BWI at the time to be the national air carrier. Mr. Huntley was responding to a call from Prime Minister Alan Chastney for Caribbean Airlines to be the national carrier. The call comes against the backdrop of complaints by some prime ministers within the region about LIAT's quality of service. Mr. Huntley says Caribbean Airlines is already the national carrier.
In 1984, when we negotiated our first air services agreement with Canada, I was the chief health services negotiator at the time, and Prime Minister Compton agreed to make, at the time, BWI, which is, and BWI succeeded by CAL, our national carrier. So when we negotiated with Canada, we used what was called the community of interest principle, where if you have a regional community, regional organization like CARICOM, one member country can nominate the airline of another country to be its national carrier.
Mr. Huntley added that it is distressing that after so many years, the region is still struggling to come up with a solution for a regional carrier. He highlighted the need for greater cooperation among CARICOM states.
Part of the problem is that we just are not cooperating because we are all tourism economies who depend on a lot on airlift. And instead of cooperating, we are being very divisive. There have been about 7 studies done. The last one done last year by the Caribbean Development Bank on air transportation policy for the Caribbean. And they've looked at, they looked at all the studies that were done before and came up with this, that one of the things is that they need to cooperate.
Mr. Huntley says putting another airline in place will not solve the problem. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Time now for Street Vibes. Here's your presenter.
Hi, I'm Alex Buske, and you're watching Street Vibes. Today we're talking crash bars. Where in St. Lucia do you think deserves priority for the installation of crash bars for the safety of our drivers?
John Compton Highway.
Why then?
Because that's where they need it, because the place is open. Open to the sea.
Somewhere in Dead William Tomaso need that. Denry proper, somewhere in the highway need that, by the school. Somewhere in Poirot area of Passenger, and what they need that area, that they need that crash bar as well. Up Latok area, somewhere there, they need that as well.
Why even they need
it? Without the vehicles. As for instance, I saw the news there somewhere, a vehicle went down in somebody's house. If they had that there, maybe that would solve a problem. So they need that for the vehicles or even people walking. If they have that sidewalk there, if the vehicle come and coming towards them and they have nowhere to run, straight in the precipice. So they need barrier everywhere in San Lucia.
By Bannon area.
Why there?
Because the last time they had an accident there and the vehicle went in the sea. I believe if they had crash bars there, probably the life would have been saved.
Well, in the city itself, deserve that a lot. Number one, when you're going down Latok section, many cars go down there, they need crash bars there. When you're going by government buildings, waterfront, they need crash bars all around the market section on the opposite side, around the arcade, they need that. When you're going down Soufre, when you're passing Anslow and Canaries, you see some precipice, especially where the Calypsonian went down. All them places need crash bars. The people haven't been working on the road because the roads are too close to precipice with no protection. Have a nice day.
Number one, Mobley by waterfront land. That's number one. Number two, up the mountain by Mambobwe there, is very dangerous. All the side of Mambobwe, when a locality citrus lack of and by citrus lack, to corner some out on Basla because they put much one for one. Okay? Bolamé a full show. Some out on Bas, they be bossing like avant poisson, for we be a good custom.
You've just been watching Street Vibes of me, Alex Buske, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Streets. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
Thank you very much, Alex. You're watching St. Lucia's television and news leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We are also online and on the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, tackling vector-borne diseases in Babineau and a call for more employers and employees to familiarize themselves with the Labor Act. Thank you so much for staying with the DBS News World. The Environmental Health Department, Babineau Youth Synergy, the Babineau Constituency Council and the Solid Waste Management Authority have partnered with WASCO to undertake a vector mitigation exercise in Babineau. The team has been holding a series of community meetings aimed at educating residents about the importance of keeping the environment clean. On Wednesday, the group met with residents at the Babineau Community Center.
The exercise builds on work already done by the Ministry of Health's Fight the Bite campaign that had residents joining cleanup efforts to eliminate mosquito breeding sites to reduce vulnerability to the Zika virus and other mosquito-borne diseases. This new campaign, however, is hoping for a more sustained effort from residents, but organizers recognize that not everyone knows where to begin. And that's where the meetings come in.
Some persons may believe that if I keep my area clean, that may not be as important as it should. But what we want to do is focus on source reduction and educate persons how important it is to just keep your surroundings clean, and also educate your neighbors as to how you can also keep the surroundings clean, because each and every one plays an important part in keeping the neighborhood clean.
Organizers recognize that while neighborhood cleanups allow residents to get rid of hard to dispose of items for free, they want to see a change in mindsets and the development of more neighborhood pride. But they say that change can only start with information.
Out of this meeting, we expect persons to be educated as to what was being shared here tonight in terms of drum covers, proper storage management for water, pest control, how to keep the area around you clean, different legislations. Also, we have persons talking about legislations for cleanliness in different communities around St. Lucia and bulk waste, especially the collection on the different days.
The Solid Waste Management Authority has more than its fair share of challenges getting adherence to waste collection days. Add to that the dumping of derelict vehicles, and it's easy to understand the prevalence of vectors and diseases in the community.
As we traverse through various communities, we notice that there's a whole buildup of derelict vehicles along the roadside, and it's the responsibility of the owners to dispose of these vehicles after either repairs or taking them apart at the Deglo landfill. And we also find that there's a high risk when it comes to these vehicles along the wayside.
The series of meetings will continue this weekend with one at the Mothers and Fathers Hall in Gara on Sunday afternoon at 5:30, another at the Foasor Community Center on the 27th at 7 p.m., and the final meeting for September will be held at Parsley's Place on the 29th, also at 7 p.m. For the DBS News World, Kendall Burton reporting.
In other news, the Central Statistical Office in St. Lucia is working with the Caribbean Community CARICOM Secretariat on a project to strengthen capacity to measure the contribution of international trade in services to the economies of the 15 member states by the trading partners. The project is funded by the European Union under the 10th European Development Fund, EDF. The International Trade in Services Statistics Pilot Study will develop and strengthen the capacity of the region to collect and disseminate international trade in services statistics. The pilot study will be performed with companies in the form of a questionnaire to explore the collection of such data. A number of companies have been selected to test this questionnaire. The general objective of the project is to provide the decision makers in CARICOM with core, high-quality statistics for the establishment and monitoring of the CARICOM Single Market and Economy, the CSME. It will be undertaken as more emphasis is being placed on the production of quality statistics in the region. Six pilot countries are involved in the project. They are St. Lucia, Antigua and Barbuda, Dominica, Grenada, Jamaica, and Suriname. A call tonight for more employers and employees to familiarize themselves with the Labor Act and its legal requirements. The call is coming from Labor Officer Andrew Quashie, who met with DBS staff today to apprise them of their rights under the Act. Don Nicholas has the details.
Several clauses within the Labor Code came up for discussion. Among them, rules governing maternity leave, sick leave, as well as what obtains when it comes to the number of hours required for the week of work.
The department was invited by management to enable myself with the Labor Department to speak with staff and management as it relates to matters of the Labor Act. Matters pertaining to employment, such as vacation, hours of work, wages, sick leave, and things of that sort. This is an ongoing process. The department engages in such activities such engagements with employers throughout the country.
The discussion was found to be very enlightening. Mr. Kwashi called on more employers to follow suit. He believes that this could avert some of the problems that occur between management and employees.
That would be welcome. As I said, we are geared towards doing that. Sometimes we invite ourselves, sometimes we are called upon to make such presentation. But the more employers who make such a request, the better it is, so that persons will be more aware, more informed, more educated about the labor laws, so you'll have less complaints and things will be done more in a better manner than to have things done wrongly and to have it be corrected by the Labor Department. So knowledge is power.
Mr. Kwashi spent nearly 3 hours on a PowerPoint presentation as he entertained questions from staff members and managers alike. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Time now for Everyday People with Alex Buske.
Meet Joseph Johnson, a man who is very cautious about his water consumption and the well-being of his family, as he says he has found himself in a grave situation because of his ignorance of facts about water.
We all know that water is like 75% of our body, right? And you would have to agree that if we're going to use water, it has to be good water.
Johnson says he once fell ill, and after a long battle with his sickness, he learned that it was caused by the water that he drank.
I fell sick. My brother came from the States, and he get to find out a way, gave me a way to test water. He got the tester through a machine that would put the alkaline back in your water.
Alkaline, he says, is the key ingredient in good water.
If you have your water is alkaline strong, diseases and so on cannot be in your body. That's the wrong atmosphere for it.
If the water is acidic, then his family is open to micro diseases, Johnson says.
I found it important to let, you know, people know what they've been drinking.
Mr. Johnson produced a color graph which can illustrate whether the water is acidic or contains alkaline. He says his water testing kit is for his safety now because of his past experience.
This is from the company that makes the alkaline machine. You see, here's acidic, acid, that's neutral, green, and down here's alkaline water. Alkaline water is the best water for your body, right? So I could test the water and we'll see which water is good for your body. This is pipe water from your home, right? If it's good, it's going to turn green, right? That means it's pure water. Put a few drops in there, see, instantly green. So that's good water. Pipe water is good water. Right? This is
a bottle water.
A bottle water. Mm-hmm. That's green as well. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't mention the name. This is yellow. It's highly acidic.
Joseph Johnson says drinking the right water now has kept him going strong and healthy, and has a few words of advice for those who do not have the luxury of owning a water testing kit as he does.
If you have water that is acidic, it would work at your cartilage, destroy your cartilage, get your bones brittle, it would harbor fat cells so you don't lose weight. You know, you get joint pains and so on, you know. So the neutral water, alkaline, unfortunately we don't have an alkaline water, but what I would suggest to people to get the water alkaline is to squeeze a lemon in the water, right? It's acidic when it's out, but it turns alkaline when it comes into your body, when it's in your body. So squeeze a lemon in the water to make it alkaline. That's the best water. In Japan, you cannot get no other water but alkaline water. That's why the people are so flexible and they live so long in Japan.
For Everyday People, I am Alex Buske.
Silicon on the DBS News World. The Calypso fraternity rallies to support two of their own who have fallen ill. Welcome back to the DBS News World. The local Calypso and Carnival fraternity has come together to stage a chanting for Get Through benefit concert for ailing Calypsonian Get Through. The concert, scheduled for Wednesday, October 12th at the National Cultural Center, will raise funds to assist with the artist's medical expenses. Alex Buske has his story.
On Thursday, the CPMA held a press launch for the Chanting for Get Through benefit concert, to be held on Wednesday, October 12th at the National Cultural Center. At the head table were chairman of the CPMA, Donovan Williams, veteran Calypsonian Ignatius Invader Thiessen, director of Carnival, Teddy Francis, tent leader of the TOT, Cecil Charles, and Stan Bishop of the Voice newspaper. According to organizers, the death of Sylvester Cauldron, better known as the Living Chassis, and the telephone for Francis Libo Dilemma, a testimony that members of the Calypso fraternity and persons in the entertainment industry have not prepared for the unfortunate circumstances that could arise.
We heard of the drive to assist our good friend Francis Libo Dilemma. We also heard of assistance being rendered to our good friend Mr. Jean Leon. And a real Calypso soldier, one of the pioneers of Calypso in St. Lucia, Get Through, as he is more popularly known, has been afflicted with an ailment and needs urgent assistance.
Tent manager of the Takeover Tent, Cecil Charles, says Get Through paved the way for and gave the opportunity to many marginalized young persons who were not accepted by the big name tents to perform.
We gave them that opportunity by starting off the Takeover Tent with, of course, Trescott Augustine. In the latter years, which is the last 5 years or so, we have noticed that he has not really taken a back seat, but he has realized that the burden and what was being done before could not be done by him and him alone. So what he basically did was to give the opportunity for persons like myself, Wayne Vitalis, Philjean Saint-Pri, to be involved in the management aspect of TOT.
The recent efforts with Libo Dilemma proved the point that artists have made themselves proud in the wider community by not instinctively and immediately going cap in hand in a mendicant manner to the government to get assistance. The fact that in a cooperative way, in a very cooperative effort, they have sought first to help themselves is certainly commendable and progressive compared to the latter era.
Ignatius Invader Thiessen lamented that Calypsonian Lady Lean has been constantly calling over the years that something be put in place for instances such as this one.
The artists should get together in the form of some sort of insurance, some group insurance, or something that they can fall back on. Act as an organization. We started off with a lot of excitement. Our first meeting, refreshments and what have you. The place was rammed. And then, as usual, the interest, especially when the artists found out that they would be required to pay at least $20 a month.
Mr. Thiessen says artists cannot continue on this trend and hopes that something is done in an effort to come to the aid of fallen artists. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Buske.
Meanwhile, a number of activities have been planned to show similar support for the leader of the So Calypso Review Tent, Jean Leon. Just as Francis Libo Dilemma and TOT Tent founder Get Through, Jean Leon fell ill a couple of months ago and is undergoing medical treatment.
As to the tents coming together to do something, I think what we want to do is to do something holistically, coming out of the whole Get Through thing, whereby rather than it's a kind of piecemeal thing, but that the whole welfare aspect of things, not just for the artists themselves, but basically for anybody who registers for the fund, who contributes to the fund, will be basically benefiting from it.
Mr. Charles says the members of the So Calypso Review Tent should be commended for their efforts and the level of support shown so far.
Come this Friday, they're also having a great big barbecue at the Police Credit Union Yard, and we only hope that persons will come and support it. Last week, Saturday, they had a big show at the Twist. That in itself was well supportive. So whatever help that persons could give in terms of supporting the artists. And of course, we know that Chacom has been very instrumental in terms of doing the Creole show for the month of Creole.
It is uncertain whether the tent will stage its annual Creole song competition in light of Leon's health issues. Sports is next when the DBS News World continues with Brian Calixt.
Thank you for staying tuned. In local cricket, the St. Lucia National Cricket Association's final competition for 2016 was launched this morning at the conference room of the Department of Youth and Sports. Participating districts were on hand to receive the tournament's fixtures as well as receive general information on the tournament.
Bowling off this coming weekend with 13 of the 16 affiliates confirmed to participate. Of the three affiliates not confirmed, it's Canaries, Deriso, and the other team, the other district, or the other affiliate is Monrepo. They have chosen not to participate because they have indicated they are getting their house in order, a new administration in there, and they are having a few challenges. They have asked that at some point the association would sit with them to discuss the way forward. It would be called the International Cricket Association T20 Cup. 29 matches in total, preliminary rounds, 22 matches in the preliminary rounds. As I said earlier, 13 of the affiliates confirmed. Briefly, Group A, Grosley, Central Castries, Hansleri, Denry. Group B, South Castries, Mabuya Valley, Babono, Labri, Vifo North. Group C, Soufre, Choiseul, Miku. The venues, three venues will be used, the Mini Philip Park, Denry, and the Philip Master Grounds. Now, we've also taking note of the weather pattern, the inconsistent weather pattern. We have moved to also provide covers for Denry and the Philip Masley ground. We just make sure that at least we have as much players as possible. All three match venues, there will be match referees. We're also going to be having the dedicated scorers at each venue. So at least in collating the statistics for the media and so on, it would be a lot easier. This year, we introducing we're trying to use the technology as much as possible. So live Facebook reporting at the innings break at each of the venues. At the innings break and at the end of the match, you will have a dedicated person doing a live Facebook report. So even if as a game has been played in Beaufort and then you are up in, let's say, Minifield Park or in Denry at the innings break, you can also be very much aware as to what's happening in the game in Beaufort or maybe the game at the other two venues. Okay? Also, in terms of the reporting of the points update at the end of every round.
Meanwhile, the St. Lucia National Cricket Association's operations manager also outlined the tournament's incentives.
So the tournament itself, in the individual match awards, we will be having the man of the match for every game, from the preliminary right up to the finals. It'd be a cash award, $50 in the preliminary round and $100 from the qualifying round. The tournament proper, at conclusion of the tournament, there will be the MVP of the tournament will be rewarded. The most runs, most wickets, most catches, most dismissals by the wicketkeeper, most sixes in the tournament, the highest individual score, the best bowling performance, the fastest 50, Any centuries scored will also be rewarded. The highest team total over 150. The champion team for this tournament will receive $3,000, the trophy, and medals. And there will be a special, well, that's one thing I can mention. The winning team will also receive a day pass for the 20 players at the Bay Gardens Water Park. Okay. In the second place team, they will receive $1,500 and medals, and also the losing semifinalists will receive $600 each.
The T20 expected to bowl off on the weekend at the Minnu Philip Park, Denry, and the Philip Master grounds. We'll see matches starting at 10 a.m. and 2 p.m. in that double headers. And finally tonight, well, Bennett King, you remember him, former coach of the West Indies team. Well, he has not ruled out the possibility of returning to coach the West Indies team for a second time. 9 years after he resigned before the expiration of a three-year contract, the Australian has an open mind as the regional authorities go in search of a replacement for the sacked Phil Simmons. King was hired as the first non-West Indian coach of the regional team in 2004, but quit after the side failed to advance to the semi-finals of the 2007 World Cup, when he felt the West Indies Cricket Board was not going to renew his contract. Well, very interesting news there. Will Bennett King be looked at again? Stay tuned. The weather is up next. The weather is brought to you by Sunbelt, your hardware store, and Caribbean Metals. We've got you covered.
Hi, I am Rufus Green, your material specialist from Caribbean Metals Limited. I am here to provide you with your better building tips on all our products, which will help you towards making the best selection for any building project, no matter the size. Today's tips is on hurricane straps and their uses. Rafter purlin clips. Connect purlins to the main supporting rafters. Rafter connectors. Connect the ends of the rafters to the sides of the ridge boards. Truss anchors. Use where main rafters are supported by concrete ring beams. Multi-purpose straps. Used to hold down lightweight buildings onto their foundations or connect rafters to ridge poles. Mending plates. Used at splice junctures as the connectors. Available at Caribbean Metals Limited at Union Industrial Estate or Gablewood South in Viewfort. Thank you for listening. Join me again for another episode of Better Building Tips with Caribbean Metals Limited.
Do it yourself and save. With a little help from Sunbelt, do it yourself and save. If you want it built, Sunbelt, your one-stop shop, drop by top buys. On all merchandise, cement, power tools, and hardware supplies. Everything you need at the best price. Quality service to suit you when you have home projects to do. If you stick and don't have a clue, our expert staff will gladly help you. Do it yourself and save. If you want it built, Sunbelt, your hardware store.
Shows Carl Parker. He's joining us from the lab today. Carl, tracking Carl.
Yeah, that's right. And the hurricane hunters are out actually in Carl right now, and they have been finding winds of 50 plus miles per hour aloft. And so they had enough evidence to go ahead and call this thing a tropical storm. Once again, it is becoming more organized. 40 mile per hour winds right now. It's moving northwest at 16 miles per hour, and the pressure 1,005. It's got a very broad area of low pressure right now. So it's just slowly becoming more organized. And as we look at the visible satellite picture, one thing that really pops out is the high cloud there. You see how the high cloud's kind of fanning out very nicely in a lot of different directions and many different sides of the storm. So that indicates that the upper level environment is a lot more favorable than it's been for days and days and days. This thing has been sheared so thoroughly for so long, and now it's got a little bit of an area of high pressure building in aloft. It's got sort of an elongated area of low pressure right now, but it's going to try to get its act together more, and we think it's got a good shot at becoming a mid to high grade tropical storm as it nears Bermuda, and that's going to be late tomorrow and then going into very early Saturday, and then it's going to race out and towards the northeast beyond that. Lisa is way out here in the Atlantic. It's going to stay out in the Atlantic. It's never going to be a threat to anything but shipping interests. And as we look at the Atlantic and the Eastern Pacific, there is a new area to watch right in there. And the models have been picking up on this in the longer term, suggesting that it could be one of those that makes its way all the way across the Atlantic. It's going to remain a weaker system and therefore stay in the easterly trade winds until it gets closer to the western Atlantic. So it may ultimately be a threat to the U.S. That's going to be something that we do need to keep a very close eye on in the coming days.
The weather is brought to you by Sunbelt, your hardware store, and Caribbean Metals. We've got you covered. Well, before we move to the thought for tonight, I would like to extend birthday wishes to my daughter, Brianna, who turned 5 today. Hope you had a fun-filled day. Now to a thought to take you through the night. Live so that when your children think of fairness, caring, and integrity, they think of you. The DBS News continues. Please stay tuned.
Finally from us, on the lighter side, a thief in the UK used the sticker on a reduced mango to try and trick a self-service machine into giving him £30 sterling off his shopping. Aidan Byrne, 22, repeatedly scanned the barcode by sticking it to the back of his bank card, but was caught after staff at the Tesco store became suspicious. He ran from the store after alerting the attention of security staff, but was later tracked down by police. The magistrate's court heard how he had bought £55 sterling worth of goods, but his receipt showed only £25 sterling in payment. He told police he committed the fraud because he was strapped for cash and did not have enough money. He admitted fraud by false representation and was fined £150 sterling. And now, the usual reminder. The Ministry of Education appeals for patience as students of the Chazelle Secondary School threaten protest action over conditions at the learning institution. Representatives from the CDB and the Eastern Caribbean Central Bank to help the government come up with a new VAT rate. The Ministry of Health not ruling out the possibility of a new mosquito-borne virus finding its way here. And multiple agencies come together to undertake a vector control project in Babano. And that's the DBS News World Broadcast. Thank you so much for watching and listening. Here's to a very good evening. Coming up at 8:30, talk with Rick Wayne. Goodbye.